Good afternoon and welcome, everybody. My name is Cheryl Reynolds. I'm with the UC Statewide IPM program, and welcome to today's UC Ag Expert Talk on air blast sprayer calibration. Peter Cusina is also on the line, and he's going to be running our polls and troubleshooting technical problems. Peter and I are both working remotely, so it may affect audio a little. Hopefully, we'll be okay today. And you can see a list of the topics that we've already covered in our webinar series. So if you want to go to that playlist, you can go check out any of the ones that you may have missed, or if you would like to view any of them again. And now I would like to introduce our speakers today. Today we have Lynn Wunderlich, who is a UCCE farm advisor for the Central Sierra, and Franz Niederholzer, a UCCE farm advisor for Colusa, Sutter, and Yuba counties. And they will both be speaking on air blast sprayer calibration. And so now we're gonna pass this over to Franz, who will be speaking first today.
Thanks very much for joining us this afternoon. I'm Franz, and I'll be covering the first half of the presentation. I'll be reading the pop-ups as they come along, and off we go. So calibration, just to define, to set everybody on the same page, it's the selection, verification, or checking, maintenance, of your sprayer setup for a known desired uniform application. If the rec says so many ounces of formulated material per acre, you have to have, you want a uniform application across the block, you have to have a calibrated sprayer to deliver that. So here's the basic calibration formula. Gallons per acre, you have to know how many gallons per acre you're spraying because you're diluting with water. How many gallons per acre you're spraying so you know the rate of material, and you know the volume of your tank, how much pesticide to put in the tank, and that's determined by the flow rate of your sprayer measured in gallons per minute, or divided by the land rate, which is acres per minute. The basic formula, once you're familiar with this, so it's very, you know, almost second nature, you'll be a long way down the road to effective spraying. Basically, calibration is about how much the sprayer is putting out, that sprayer rate, divided by how much land is being treated in that same amount of time. That's the land rate. Okay, so this one formula can be used to calibrate a 1 gallon hand sprayer or a monster twin 45 inch fan engine drive sprayer. It's basically, you know, how much the sprayer is putting out, the spray rate divided by how much land is being treated in the same amount of time. Now, there's a little bit more to calibrating the big sprayer than the little sprayer, but the same fundamentals are there. If you remember that spray rate over land rate, you can calibrate either one of them. So, just to break that down a bit, the flow rate and the land rate are the variables you need to check no matter what formula or sprayer you're using. We looked a moment ago at the, you know, the gallons per acre's flow rate over land rate. You can break that down into gallons per minute that the sprayer is putting out, divided by the speed of the sprayer in feet per minute, multiplied by the row width to give you your area square feet per minute, which you can translate, you know, you can put that into acres per minute. If you solve for the flow rate, looking for gallons per minute is gallons per acre times the speed times the row width. Commonly, you'll see this formula at the bottom of the page, which is the basic formula reworked to use miles per hour instead of feet per minute, but you've got gallons per acre times the speed in miles per hour times the row width in feet, and that 495 conversion factor allows you to use miles per hour and come up with gallons per minute. Just a conversion factor. Sometimes on the internet and some companies have use 500 instead of 495. I think they're just rounding up to an easier number to remember. The difference between 495 and 500 is 1%, and it will not make much of an impact on your calculations, but 495 is the accurate number. So we'll go with that today. So again, gallons per acre, flow rate over land rate. The flow rate comes from the nozzles. The land rate, as we've seen, is speed, but it's also row width. It's not just the tractor speed, it's the area covered by the nozzles per unit time, the swath width, trunk to trunk measurement in vineyards and orchards and groves. So it's the speed of your rig by the width that it's influencing. And I realize that air blast sprayers influence beyond that row they're spraying, but that influence is variable based on having sprayed through that first row. So the swath width is always considered the width of the row you're spraying down. So your speed in seconds, convert that to feet per minute. You multiply your feet per minute by the row spacing to give you square feet per minute. divide that by square feet in an acre, and you've got acres per minute, which is the input to your basic calibration formula. So, but the steps to take the calibrator sprayer, you know, determine the ground speed that best fits the orchard and crop stage or vineyard or grove and the crop stage. I realize in a citrus orchard or an avocado grove, your canopy is not going to change much during the year, but in orchards I work in and the vineyards Lynn works in, we see quite a change in the canopy structure leaf area in the course of the of a year. Measure ground speed, measure whatever that ground speed is that you've determined is the best one for that particular site at that time. With a sprayer parked in your orchard, determine the number of nozzles you want to use. Determine a recommended volume per acre from your PCA or experience. Calculate the gallons per minute to deliver that gallons per acre at the given land rate. Ground truth that gallons per minute to make sure it's correct. And then check your spray coverage and you will have, if everything matches up and you're comfortable with the results, you're well calibrated for the season. Or for that, or again, depending upon the practice, that particular spray. So in vigorous large trees, sprayer speed is the most critical management option input for effective coverage and pest management. It's not the only important management option, but it's the first one to get right. You can do all the others properly, but if the tractor speed is too fast and the fan is not allowed to carry the pesticide, the air from the fan carries the pesticide to the tree, and if the air from the fan doesn't reach that part, all parts of the tree, those parts aren't protected. And a big part of the fans of the tractor, the sprayer's ability to reach throughout the tree, is the speed at which the sprayer passes any one particular tree or vine and has the time at which that fan works in that tree. So ground speed is critical. They're all those factors are important, but this is the first one and it's the most important because it's the one you've got to get right to make everything else work. So again, it's the first step, get your ground speed right. That's the biggest influence on air movement in the canopy. For most of the big sprayers that I'm familiar working with, many of them have welded steel fans. There's limited flexibility as far as adjusting the amount of air that comes out of the fan as you're driving down the row. So the speed at which you drive down the row is the biggest factor affecting the amount of air that goes into each tree. And I love this quote from Tim Smith, who was a retired extension agent up in Washington State working with apples. You can do a bad job at any spray gallonage because if the spray doesn't get there, doesn't matter whether you're at 500 gallons an acre or 50 gallons an acre, if the air carrying a spray doesn't get there, you're not going to get the job done. So the proper ground speed results from watching and assessing the interaction of the sprayer speed, the canopy, the size and density. Again, apologies to the avocado and citrus folks, although the age of the orchard or the grove could affect it there as you move from a new planting to an older planting. And then finally, the fan itself, the diameter of the fan, the pitch, the speed at which it's spinning. Now, a good analogy that I took this picture from Hardy's training manual, but think of the speed of the tractor working down a grove or a vineyard is like filling, the hose is filling glasses and you've seen this picture. The sprayer needs to move slow enough so that the fan delivers air throughout the entire canopy, but fast enough that it's not blasting off the treetops and wasting money. You want to fill the glasses, but not overfill them. So the sprayer speed is represented by the rate of the hose movement along the row of glasses. The canopy size and diameter is represented by the size of the glasses, and the fan air delivery, the pitch and the diameter, the RPM of the PTO of the engine is represented by the flow rate of the water in the hose. Time is money, so you want to drive as fast as possible, but poor crop protection can cost more money than you save driving fast. Oftentimes it really can. The goal is to drive fast enough to move spray through the canopy, but not much further. Just here's an example of what happens if you drive too fast. This is data from Joel Siegel, tree height over here. And the percent loss in navel orange worm control when you move from 2 to 2.5 miles an hour. Down low, there's a small amount. And over here, it's 2 to 3.5 miles an hour. But the point being, as you move higher in the tree, you move further away from control that you would get at 2 miles an hour because The faster you go, the less of the air from the fan reaches higher in the canopy, and you don't get the coverage, and hence you don't get the protection. And then most of the crops I work in that don't get a lot of pruning, majority of your crop is from the middle up. And if you drive too fast, that's where your coverage falls apart first. So that's tractor speed affecting coverage. The size of the glass, the size of your target crop canopy influences how fast the hose should move to fill each glass without overflowing it. How big is the glass or orchard or vineyard at any one time is critical to an efficient application. So here you have a very early season vineyard. Now, is it this or is it this? Yeah, I think I'd go with that. Whereas in a much further along to the season, it's much bigger than it was earlier. So now you're looking at a much larger volume, much slower traffic, much more air needing to pass through the canopy. So you're looking at a bigger glass to fill, therefore a slower hose movement or more airflow or some combination of the two. When you shift to country I'm more familiar with, we've got almonds at pink bud. They're just beginning to bloom. There's not much to reduce or to hinder air movement to the canopy. You've got a pretty small glass to fill. You might have a little bit bigger glass when you get to full bloom, but of course, prior to harvest, when you've got a very dense canopy and it's weighed down by heavy crop, you're looking at much higher airflow required to move through the canopy. And finally, the fan itself. The larger the diameter of the fan, the tighter the pitch influences the amount of airflow delivered. Also, the bigger the diameters you see here, this data from rears, a 22-inch fan requires only a 16-horsepower tractor, PTO tractor. When you move up to a 36-inch fan, you need at least a 50-horsepower tractor. The pitch is variable. Some of these vineyard sprayers or smaller orchard sprayers, the pitch is variable. They've got aluminum fans and you can adjust the pitch. So that also affects flow of air. The larger the fan diameter, the more air it's going to move and the more horsepower it's going to need. And also the same with the pitch. Rears makes very large welded steel fans for their bigger engine drive and PTO sprayers, but they're all say 38-inch or 36-inch, 33-inch, but they weld them at different pitches. So you can swap out the fans themselves instead of changing the pitch as you see. This is possible on this unit here. You can also, and for welded steel fans, you can adjust the gearing and the PTO, the tractor's PTO or the engine drive engine's RPMs to influence the air delivery from the fan or in our analogy, the flow of water in the hose to fill the glasses. As you increase an engine RPM in a PTO unit, this data is from a 30-inch fan welded non-adjustable pitch fan that TurboMist puts out. You increase in the miles per hour, you basically double it, whether you're in the low gear in the fan or the high gear in the fan. The miles per hour that the fan's putting out is not in itself all that important, but when you have a fixed exit for the fan's airspeed, the amount of volume that the fan of air that the fan is going to throw is going to be directly related to the miles per hour. So you can change the airflow about 20% by dropping down from high to low gearbox and dropping your miles per hour or your RPMs on the tractor about 20%. So you can adjust even when you don't have a adjustable pitch unit. So those are the factors that to consider when you're to determine your proper ground speed. Also need to talk about the obvious problems that if you don't get that relationship right. We've talked about not being able to get good pest control, but you also end up with situations like this where the fan is it's an ineffective application. It's also a bit of a PR problem. On the other hand, if the air is not sufficient, you can end up with a kind of a shingling effect at the edge of a canopy like this, where the the leaves aren't pushed back and the air allowed and the spray allowed to flow through the canopy, and you get buildup of, in this case, this is potassium nitrate foliar feed, and the air was just kind of brushing along and accumulated on the leading edges of the leaves. And it, as it dried, it concentrated and you get some phyto. There's no damage to the, no crop damage, but you don't get good uniform coverage throughout the canopy when the exterior of the canopy, insufficient air is applied to not allow the material to move through the canopy. So just for review, there's the problem. So just for review, faster ground speed, less airflow, and every other row is effective with this particular light canopy. When you got full bloom, where you've got the flowers themselves that can put some sort of resistance, your faster ground speed still works. Less airflow in fan gear, tractor RPMs, et cetera, still helps, but you can't do every other row because it interferes, the airflow is reduced just enough that the backside coverage is going to be insufficient. Whereas over here in the very, very early, maybe 5% bloom, the research says that the backside of the tree does have sufficient coverage at very, very early in the season. And then finally, in late pre-bloom, probably pre-harvest, slow ground speed, lots of airflow, and no use of every other row provides you the most effective coverage. So how to, that's the theory behind it all. How do you determine what a proper ground speed is at any one time in a particular orchard, vineyard, or grove? Flagging, colorful surveyor's tape flagging is cheap. You can find it in most hort stores or even box stores. It shows where the air goes. The best way I know to see if sprayer fan air passes through the tree or vine canopy, it's as high as surveyor's tape flagging to the far side of the canopy of the vines or the top of the tree. Both of those are the toughest places for the air to get to. In an orange grove or a citrus grove or avocado, it would again be the top of the canopy. Here in the vineyard, you tie some flagging on the backside of a row. You want the sprayer to be traveling over here, and you watch as the sprayer drives by at a particular setting for the sprayer and the tractor, what the ribbon does. If it just hangs there, dead hang, you need to slow down because you're not getting air moving through and interacting, it's not moving the ribbon. If it kicks straight out flat, you've got too much air running through the canopy and you can speed up or somehow otherwise influence the airflow through the canopy, reduce it so that you're not blowing material totally through the tree and ending up, painting the ground over here with the product that you paid to put on the crop. In trees, if it's flattened out, you don't want to speed up. If it's hanging straight down, you need to slow down, get more air movement. And if you're out there about roughly 45 degrees off, somewhere in that range, note your settings on the tractor and the sprayer. You've got your appropriate ground speed for that particular vineyard at that particular time. Now in nut trees that I work with, the upper canopy is the hardest area to reach. And I suspect that'd be the same with avocados and citrus. So use flagging to make sure the air is traveling to the treetops and just above. And here's just a bit of a video I think should show my point. Like any good show, we just missed the best part, but what happens in the video is that flagging kicks straight up 180 off the vertical. Tractor's moving too slow for that particular setting. A grower could save money by driving a little bit faster and you would still be getting air up to that type of that height of the tree. So I apologize, you got all the buildup twice and not the last few seconds that showed the flagging kicking up. But here it is in the same idea in a vineyard. There's the flagging flying straight out. The sprayer could drive faster or the pitch could be adjusted or gearbox could be shifted. Some way of backing off the air to allow them not to move the material that you're paying to have in the tank past the row that you intend to get material on. Okay, so assuming that you've found the tractor gearing and RPMs and the setting for the fan on the sprayer. You've got the information you need. This is how fast you want to, or that's the settings for good coverage. Now you have to figure out how fast the tractor is traveling using those good settings, or the proper settings. So with your known tractor speed, tractor and sprayer gearings and settings for good coverage that you just checked at that stage, measure how fast you're really going. Don't use the speedometer on the tractor. That was set at the factory for a set of wheels or tires that may not be on the unit, may not have been all that accurate. It might be, but a lot would be riding on making that not checking and just taking the word for it. So you have to measure how long it takes to travel at least 100 feet. So in the vineyard, do the same thing, vineyard or orchard or in a grove. You measure out at least 100 feet in the terrain you're spraying in. Don't do this on a nice firm road. Do it in the field where you plan to spray. Then from a running start, drive the tractor down the row using those settings that you've spent the time to determine. How many seconds it takes to make that run. And make sure the sprayer is up to speed when it reaches the starting point, which is where this gentleman's standing with his stopwatch and his phone timer right there. So it's not a standing start. You want to be up to everything up to the operating settings you want by the time it passes the flagging here. So then you'll have your ground speed in feet per second. So to determine the land rate, you've got feet, and you take your feet per second, divide that by 60 to get feet per minute. So you've got your feet per minute times the width of your, in this case, it's 10 feet of your row spacing. The measured feet per minute here was 222 feet per minute, and you've got 10-foot row spacings. So you've got 2,220 square feet per minute. To convert this to acres per minute, which you need to plug into that basic formula, you divide by the 43,560 square feet in an acre, and this sprayer at that speed and at that all the settings you want have established is covering 0.05 acres per minute. In an orchard setting, or perhaps a grove setting, same ground speed, much wider row spacings. You've got more than twice the area treated per time. You divide that by your acreage, your acres, square feet per acre, and you get your acres treated per minute. So just to review, at the same ground speed, 222 feet per minute, which is 2.5 miles per hour, your acres per minute more than doubles as the swath width goes from 10 to 22 feet. You're treating much more area of the orchard with every minute down the row at the same ground speed with the wider rows. So that's the calculation on acres per minute. And the critical part about all this is it's calculation of acres per minute at a proper ground speed that will allow you good coverage. That's the critical part. It's setting the ground speed that moves the air throughout the entire canopy, not too far, not too short, and then calculating or noting down the tractor settings, the sprayer settings, and then determining the speed that you're getting that good coverage with. And you can proceed now with the second half. You can plug that into the denominator on your basic formulation. 8 gallons per acre is gallons per minute over acres per minute. So we have the bottom portion, the acres per minute portion of the equation worked out. Now Lynn's up next. Take it away, Lynn.
The relationship is gallons per acre equals flow rate over land rate. So by relationship, we mean that if something changes, say in the flow rate, if the flow rate increases, but nothing else changes, it's a direct relationship to gallons per acre. So if the flow rate increases, the gallons per acre also increases. And as Franz just tested us on, it's an inverse relationship with the land rate component. So if the row spacing increases, the GPA decreases. Okay, so far we've gone over land rate, Franz did an excellent job of that. And it is such an important part of the calibration formula. And it's why I really do like this this formula rather than the GPM formula, because this formula doesn't assume that we know the miles per hour. You have to measure it, and measuring it's very important. So, you know, it's a speed selected based on the canopy, the fan, and the tractor speed. So we calculate that. We measure that tractor speed using the ribbons. We get the speed right, looking for the interaction with the fan and the canopy. We multiply that by the row width. We convert that to acres per minute. Then typically gallons per acre is estimated based on canopy size. So typically that is based on experience, how you, in the past, how you've felt that your coverage was good. But if you don't worry about it. You can be an estimate, and you can use that estimate to solve for flow rate, and then you can check it at the end by checking for good coverage. Okay, so for example, if we say we're spraying citrus and we choose a 200 gallons per acre application rate, that's what we desire to get good coverage. Using the 0.11 acre per minute, using the speed that Franz just showed us, if we do the algebra, 200 times 0.11, we'd be looking for 22 gallons per minute coming out of the entire sprayer. So again, how do we coming out of the entire sprayer, but we've got a set of nozzles to choose from. So how do we choose what nozzles to use? Typically, we line our sprayer up next to the canopy. We apply some flagging or maybe just a pole, and we choose the number of nozzle banks we want to use. That's the first step. Then we take that calculated total GPM and divide it by the number of nozzles we think will be adequate for covering the canopy, and we get a flow rate per nozzle. This is if all nozzles were the same. So that brings us to nozzles. So let's talk about nozzles a little. Okay, so this is your typical disc and core setup. We have a nozzle body, very important, the nozzle strainer or filtration. These should be cleaned prior to every start of every spray day, ideally. This is not a lot of space in here, so you're asking a lot of this small nozzle, this small hole in the nozzle to deliver, especially if that nozzle strainer is clogged. Then we have the core, sometimes also referred to as the spinner plate. This is a four-hole core. And the nib is placed towards the sprayer. So that would go in facing down towards the filter, and then the disc on top. So basically, two nozzles coming together for one flow rate. And we often get the question, how often should nozzles be changed? And nozzle really depends on the pressure of the system, the type of material that the nozzle is made out of, and the pesticide formulation. So you can have some very abrasive pesticides, such as the wettable powders are often pretty abrasive. Nozzle material does make a difference. And we know that ceramic nozzles can be more expensive. And actually, in my experience, it really helps to shop around for nozzles because you can find them less expensive if you do some comparison shopping. Here they are, 90 to 200 times greater resistance ratio than a brass or, for example, a stainless steel nozzle. The greater the resistance ratio, the more resistant to wear that nozzle is. So ceramic nozzles are more expensive. They can be somewhat fragile to use. You have to be careful not to tighten them too much with a wrench, but they are really great as far as longer lasting nozzles. They don't need to be changed as often as a brass or a hardened stainless steel. So what does the nozzle contribute to our spray application? In air blast application really two things. Flow rate, so the gallons per minute, it's, as I said, directly proportional to the application rate. So if you want a larger spray volume, you can increase the flow rate by either increasing the nozzle size or in some cases increasing pressure. There's a consequence to using pressure to increase your flow rate, and that is because it produces smaller drops, except in Venturi sprayers where droplets are always fine. The second thing that the nozzle contributes is the droplet size. And this is extremely important when we think about drift, which I think of as the opposite of coverage. So we all want and strive for good coverage. Droplet size can be affected by the nozzle type and the design, the system pressure, and the sprayer type, as well as weather conditions. So here we have a typical disc and core. This is from the T-Jet catalog manufacturer's chart showing as we increase pressure on the top of the chart here. And here's a combination of say a D6 and a core 25. So as we go across the chart here to read it, at these are the flow rates at the various pressures, right? So one of the things we see is that as we increase pressure, flow rate also increases, but it's not a one-to-one increase. And you can see that here. It's actually, you have to double the flow rate. You have to increase the pressure times. It's a squared relationship. And so that's one of the reasons why it's often better to change the nozzle itself. If you're looking for a flow rate that's much greater than what the nozzle can deliver, better to change the nozzle than to try and increase the pressure to achieve that flow rate. Because as you see here at 10 PSI, this combination of nozzles delivers 0.1 gallon, four times that 0.19, four times the pressure to get double the flow rate. So we were going back to our example, we were looking for a nozzle that could deliver 0.69 gallons per minute by the nozzles that were given. So we're shooting for a nozzle close to that. And at about 100 PSI, which is typically what we like to use, we can see a flow rate of 0.70, which is close enough. Just to remind you that the pressure gauge is an essential component. So it's incredibly common to see these gauges, not operating properly, being hard to read. And they should, it's a relatively inexpensive piece of equipment and it should be maintained and in a range that makes sense for the application. Typically we think about looking at a range that goes about double the application so that you can easily see the what the pressure is. And remember that the pressure gauge is tells the operator that flow is happening. So as you're often the mixer loader jumps on the tractor, he's busy looking ahead to spray. Be careful to spray the rows and not cause tractor blight. And so the pressure gauge is one thing that he can or she can pretty easily look behind their shoulder and see if the pressure gauge is working, the flow is happening. And here's those TXR cone jet nozzles. These are relatively new, although it looked like, I think, I can't remember, 20% of you are already using these. Have some advantages in that they're color coded. And I call these single piece nozzles. They're actually come apart and they have a ceramic piece in there. So it's a ceramic piece in the center with a hardened plastic body around it. So color coding is kind of nice because it helps with being able to set up the sprayer or tell someone how to set up sprayer up based on color coding. The color coding, here's that chart for the TXR cone jets. Now we're starting to see something different in the middle of the chart, right? So we're still seeing that with increasing pressure for any given nozzle, we see an increase in flow rate. But what's all this red VF, orange F? So that's starting to tell us something about droplet size. So these nozzles produce fine or very fine droplets. And we're starting to see some information given to the user about that. Again, we were shooting for 0.69 and here would be at 120 PSI. We could choose this TXR-804 to do that job. Let's talk a little bit more about droplet size and why droplet size matters. So we have to think about droplets are measured in microns, and a micron is very, very tiny, 0.00004 inches in diameter. So droplets are measured in microns. And even when we're talking about large droplets, 400, you know, micron droplet is considered coarse, it's still in microns. It's still pretty small relative to, you know, other things that we think about in size. But here's a chart looking at the movement of spray particles based on different droplet size. And what we see is that those coarse droplets, you know, drop out of the air fairly quickly, 2 seconds to fall 10 feet, and move only 8.5 feet laterally in 3 miles per hour wind, which is a pretty good, what we would call a good spray day wind. But these very fine droplets, they stay suspended in air longer, which the longer those droplets stay suspended in air, the more likely they are to go off target, right? For something to go wrong, so they can get carried away. And those droplets travel as, you know, this very fine droplet can travel 1,100 feet in a 3 mile per hour wind. So droplet size really does matter. And there, I'm really glad to see some of you using the air induction drops, and that's there is a good spot for the place for them, I think, in an air blast application. Weather also affects droplets, and that's because as the relative humidity goes down and temperatures go up, the droplets shrink. You know, think of a drop, they're mainly water in the formula. So as those droplets shrink, you might switch to a low drift nozzle, a larger drop nozzle, or consider not spraying. Likewise, inversion layers are always no spray days. Okay, so signs of an inversion layer like this hanging fog here means the reason you don't spray is because those drops will become suspended in that inversion and likely move off target. And that can be a very dangerous situation. So the larger the number, the larger on the disc, if you're using a disc and core, the larger the exit hole, the greater the flow rate and droplet size. So choosing a larger disc can also be a way to achieve a large drop, as well as this AITX nozzle. This is an air induction nozzle. They've been around for years for herbicide applications. We now have them for air blast applications. Air is introduced in this hole right here and mixes with the formula to form a larger drop. Okay, you see in the AITX chart, the droplet size is now going to these more larger drop, these color codes for the drops are moved towards these green, more environmentally friendly droplet sizes. And again, you know, we're looking for a 0.69 flow rate, and you know, we can get pretty close to that with an AITX. So that is an option for us. For those with a Venturi sprayer, like this Gearmore, which is common in vineyards, where's the nozzle on this, or where's the flow being controlled here? It's right here at the metering disc, right? So this is all an outlet. These fan and fingers are all outlet. This disc is what controls the flow rate, whether you have one or all four of these outlets open. And like the other nozzles, you can download the manufacturer's chart, and you really should have these charts. Who's ever doing the calibrating should have this. These charts, they're available online. They're available in Spanish for most. And this will, again, tell you the same principle: increase pressure, increase flow rate. You can get the flow rate from the, and you should. I mean, that's how you choose your nozzles, right? But it doesn't stop there, right? We really need to verify that nozzle flow rate. We need to measure it. And that's because there's several reasons why the flow rate might not be the same as what the catalog says. We could have a worn nozzle. We could have a plugged filter. We could have a slightly different pressure. Even in our experience, brand new nozzles sometimes have a different flow rate, significantly enough that you'd want to know it than what the manufacturer's catalog says it is. So we've got a couple of methods that we typically, Franz and I, when we teach our hands-on course, we go through these methods on how to verify nozzle flow rate. And the first one is the bucket method, and it works pretty much for anybody. You don't need any fancy tools for this method. You simply fill the tank with clean water. We're always using just water in calibration. That's the best way to do it. No pesticide in the tank. And there's residue. So of course we still have our minimal PPE on. We fill the tank with clean water and we park it on level ground. And you fill it to, as this photo shows here, a verifiable spot. So somewhere where when you open the hatch to the tank, you can make a little mark there with a piece of tape or even a Sharpie, or sometimes often we just fill it into the very top. So you know where that is, because you're going to want to refill it back up to that spot. So that's very important. Then you bring your sprayer up to 540 RPM, your engine RPM for the PTO. You're going to open it up. And so often, maybe the first time you do this, you're going to check for leaks on the nozzles that you just changed. And then you're going to have to go and refill your tank up again. And so everything's good. Your nozzles are not leaking. It's all ready to go. You open it up and you spray it out while noting the pressure and the time. So this requires someone to work with the driver, someone who's got a stopwatch, is going to start it when all of the nozzles to be used are open and stop it after 30 seconds or perhaps a minute, depending on how you're going to refill it. The longer you can run it, the better it is, because it sort of works out the kinks in the flow. Always checking the system pressure, because that affects flow rate. Then you're going to refill it, and here we've got Franz demonstrating refilling it with just a bucket. And it's a calibrated bucket. And in my experience, if you buy a bucket, you might find several different units labeled on the bucket. It could be imperial gallons, which is not the same as U.S. gallons or liters. So I always like to make a mark to remind me where the U.S. gallon is, or you can just calibrate your own simple bucket and refill it, noting the volume. And this works really great. And it works also for a Gearmore. So you can do the same thing with Gearmore, Venturi, Electroblast, any of those air shear types of sprayers. You can spray it out and refill it. Another way we can do this is we can unhook. And in my experience, this is really easy to do with an air shear sprayer. You can unhook, here's where your metering valve is. So you can unhook the hose and measure directly the flow rate right here, paying attention to the time and pressure. So that's the bucket method. That's the entire sprayer. Sometimes we also, it's nice to verify the flow rate from individual nozzles. And that requires some sort of an adapter that fits over the nozzle without impeding flow. So it can be homemade or purchased. And this is our homemade nozzle adapter that we made with, I think this is a dishwasher appliance part here, this black part. with a brass hose bib and a ring clamp there. And then we just would clamp the hose on here. Or you can purchase these from AAMS Salvarani is one company that sells these types of adapters, and they fit nicely. They've got this nice rubber gasket that fits nicely over the nozzle, and you can measure it using a tool if you'd like, such as the Spot On. The Spot On is a piece of equipment that we like because it doesn't require a stopwatch. So it's pre-calibrated. It's got a trip wire here and a trip up here. And once it's full, it will give you the gallons per minute if that's the units that you choose. It's pretty easy to use. In this photo, this person who's holding it should be holding it straighter. So it's important to hold it straight to capture the flow straight for those trip wires to work correctly. It's also really important to pre-wet this filter at the top. These are available through Gemplers, through I think InnoQuest sells them online. They're about $200-some, not a pretty handy tool. Okay, so we've heard our nozzle rate, and now we want to put that into our formula. So we're going back to our basic formula. Gallons per acre equals flow rate over land rate. Our land rate is set. Our row spacing and our tractor speed is set. We've chosen our nozzles. We've tried to get them close to our desired 200 gallons per acre. And what we're doing here is we're just inputting actual flow rates that we've measured of these 32 nozzles, 100 PSI, to give us what the actual flow rate is. It's an important step. And so in this example, I chose, okay, we've got 32 nozzles here. I said, hey, 10 of them are delivering 0.67 gallons per minute, 12 are delivering 0.65 gallons per minute, and so on, so that our actual flow rate turns out to be 21.23 gallons per minute. And so that's the number I'm going to use in my formula to give me my actual gallons per acre. And so this is what that sprayer is actually going to be delivering, not 200, but 193 gallons per acre. Okay, and then finally, you know, we always wanna check our calibration. You know, was that estimate of 200 gallons per acre a good one? Does that make sense? Do we get the coverage that we want? And so we really like to use water sensitive paper. It's not perfect, but it's pretty darn good indication of whether you get sprayed at the target. And I like to put the water sensitive paper in near the bunch, if that's in the case of grapes, if that's what I'm targeting. You know, place the water sensitive where you're trying to target. In this case, in this photo, I'm using one of those cattle ear tags that and have attached it to the vine. This is a permanent place for someone to go in and then attach the water sensitive paper to. You can also use a mailing tag or you can use a pin or a stapler and staple it in, all different ways that you can attach water sensitive paper. You can use a pole to attach it to. All different ways, and it does give you, really gives you a presence or absence indication, did the spray hit the target? And this is really just my last slide here is just a plug for our online course. We, Franz and I, Peter and Cheryl and others have worked as a pest management alliance with funding from the California Department of Pesticide Regulation to develop a air blast spray application course, and we're very excited to be rolling it out this fall. So it's an interactive course. It's got 5 modules. It will have continuing education credits attached to it. And we try to cover all of what we've covered today in greater detail, because it is a lot of material, as well as the components of the air blast sprayer, more on drift, more on wide calibration, more on calibration calculations. So we hope you'll check that out. And with that, I'm hoping that we can address some of these questions that have piled up.
So let me, I'll just take them in the order that came in and you guys can chime in. So the first one, spray sensitive paper is effective, but does it tell the whole story when using silicone surfactants?
I'll answer and then I'll let Franz add anything he wants to. It doesn't tell the whole story ever, unfortunately. There's limitations to water-sensitive paper, and one of those is that it's not reacting to the spray drop as a plant tissue would. So it's a piece of paper with a coating on it. It's not a leaf. It's not a waxy leaf. It's not a waxy piece of fruit. I'm not sure how the silicone surfactant, it would probably show droplet spread on there. I think what's tricky about using water sensitive paper in my experience is just thinking about as a user, what coverage is good enough, you know, and there are several apps, SnapCard and Smart Spray that will take a photo of that water sensitive card and tell you the percent coverage. And in speaking with Jason DeVoe, who authors the Sprayers 101 website that we're big fans of, and he, you know, he gives an estimate of about 18% coverage being good coverage. And when you look at a card with 18% coverage for most applications, I should say, that is not as many drops as maybe most people would think. So that's a long-winded answer. So spray coverage is cheap, relatively cheap. It tells you, did the spray hit it or not? It does not pick up very, very fine drops either. So, Franz, I don't know. I'm probably talked too much here. Do you have anything to add?
No, I think you made a great point. The water-sensitive paper are not leaves, but they show, you know, are you getting spray there? And if you take 4 or 5 or 10 water-sensitive papers from a tree and lay them all out, are you getting similar coverage? Is it much worse here than there? It allows you to adjust your sprayer to try to get more uniform coverage, but that's really about, as you say, that's about all you can do. But the experts say that is, gets you a long way down the road to a good spray job. So if you really wanted to see how a surfactant looked or coverage looked with a surfactant, you could try surround in a surfactant, see what the how white they were, things like that. But you're right. It's not, doesn't tell the whole story, but there isn't much out there that does.
All right. For the next question, at what height in a nut tree, such as walnuts, will ground applications no longer be effective?
That's a good question. The people I've talked to in different parts of the world feel that spray coverage above 25 feet gets sketchy. A lot depends upon the material you're using and the target, you know, but, tall walnut trees are hard to get good coverage, especially in the tops. And, you know, you need to stack your nozzles at the very top of the shoulders of the sprayer to, you know, use a volute. But I think above 25 feet, you know, check your sprayer in your sight. But it does get limited as you move above 25 feet. That's what I've been told and have seen a little bit.
So the next one is, how does one take account of wind speed and wind direction when making sprays?
Well, several parts to that answer, I guess I would think. One is make sure your applicator really knows the sensitive boundary areas and the adjacent sites, and that someone, either the applicator or the supervisor, and they're communicating someone is measuring weather effects during the application, because wind speed and wind direction can change. And when wind speeds get above 8 miles per hour, 7 or 8 miles per hour, or in gusty situations, really should not be spraying. And certainly if wind direction, is towards the sensitive areas and moving off the farm, we should not be spraying. So we really should stop spraying then. I'm not sure if that answers the question. I'm not exactly sure what the question, if the question is more, how to choose a large enough fan, or having a fan that will, part of the fan's job is to move the droplets against, what we would consider good wind speeds for spraying, but wind speeds that still might interfere with droplets reaching the target. And so that could have something to do with fan size and fan direction, the direction of the air. Franz, do you have anything to add to that?
I agree. You're using fan speed, airflow, and droplet size to overcome the wind, the ambient wind. You can, if the wind is crosswind to the rows, you can cheat into the canopy depending upon the row width. In orchards, if you've got a 22-foot row width, you can cheat. You can drive into the tree a bit, or towards the tree, so your fan's not pushing as far into the wind. I've seen some research that suggests using bigger drops. They've got more mass. They carry into the wind better. Some of those,
and they don't move as far.
Air induction nozzles that Lynn was talking about with the big fat drops, they will carry farther into the wind, have more momentum, more kinetic energy. They'll travel farther into the wind than will finer droplets. But Lynn's got a point. Your spray job's not going to be nearly as good when the wind comes up, and makes it more of a challenge. But if the wind is towards sensitive site, it's very risky.
Okay, so the next question is just a clarification, Lynn. So when you're talking about the nib on the spinner plate, does it go inwards towards the strainer or outwards towards the disc?
Yes, the nib or nipple on the spinner plate goes inwards towards the strainer, towards the sprayer. So towards the strainer, not out towards the disc. And if you think about it, if that nib is pointing out towards the disc hole, it's going to block that hole. So it makes some sense, but sometimes that gets flipped around and people aren't paying quite enough attention there. That's one of the nice things, in addition to durability, about the ceramic nozzles is they don't have, the cores don't have a nib. So there's no wrong way to put in a ceramic core if you choose to use those. But you can crack them if you over-tighten them, so.
Okay, and then is it best to change all nozzles at the same time to keep the coverage uniform?
If you are measuring, well, yes. I mean, if it's time to change one nozzle and you put them all in the sprayer at the same time, it's probably time to change them all. And they are relatively inexpensive, especially when we consider how expensive our materials are these days. So, if you're measuring individual flow and you see one that is off, I think it's perfectly fine just to replace that one.
Okay. The next one, have you or other advisors vetted any of the spray calibration apps, and when do they work or what might they miss?
Okay. Yeah. I have used, I'm forgetting it now. The app is it Smart Card. They all kind of have the similar names, Spray Smart. There's Smart Spray, Snap Card. I've used SnapCard. So there's SnapCard, there's Smart Spray, and there's Dosavenia. And I've used SnapCard to take photos to try and get a percent coverage on cards. And they have their, you know, I think there's a place for these applications, but I don't think they take the place of really understanding calibration and the formula. So I'm not an advocate of using an app to do the calculation for you. There can be errors there, or, you know, but the other thing about using the SnapCard or any other, it uses your phone camera to take a picture of the spray card, the water sensitive paper. And depending on the light, and the, how you position your camera, you can get different readings. So, there's some tricks to using them. I think they're a tool in the toolbox.
The calibration formulas the software I've used, apps or software, have been really helpful in quickly trying to reach a certain gallons per acre, estimate a certain gallons per acre. But you still have to ground check it. You know, those apps use catalog numbers for spray flows that are not always what you'll see in the field. You have to do what Lynn and I have been talking about. You have to measure your ground speed. You have to measure your sprayer flow rate. Then you'll know what that sprayer puts out. If the app is just drawing on numbers from a catalog, you're probably pretty close, you hope. But you could be off 10%, and that comes to a pretty significant amount of money and time and possibly trouble with pest management. So they're helpful, but they're not, they don't replace what we've been talking about today.
The next question is, would you ever want to use different size nozzles at the top of the round nozzle mount than the side of the mount to allow a different volume to move higher into the canopy?
Take it.
Franz, you're muted. Oh, there we go.
Absolutely. I just was hoping the arms waving was, the nozzles go radially out, the flow goes radially out, and the amount of tissue to cover is almost never the same from the bottom to the top of the nozzles. And especially with big trees that I work in, you can oftentimes, I'll set up a sprayer for 80% of the gallonage to come out of the top four or five nozzles, because that's where the nuts are. And anything that goes up with a reasonable size droplet size on it's going to come back down again. Absolutely. I don't think you'll be as successful in your spray application without making that adjustment, without targeting the canopy with the volume, as opposed to just having the same rate of flow from every nozzle port on the machine.
And then I think the last one is just, what is the maximum relative humidity to make an adequate spray?
Oh, maximum. Well, you don't want any, I don't know. We're usually concerned about minimum. You don't want any dew. You don't want any wetness on the leaves. So I don't know the answer to that question, Franz. Do you know, is it 75% or you don't want any wetness on the leaves because that's going to interfere with the spray, dilute it basically. So maximum relative humidity to make an adequate spray.
Yeah, don't spray in the fog.
Yeah, here it's so dry, we don't contemplate that, I'm sorry to say. I don't know. Yeah, you don't. I think it would take you to, you'd need to actually go out there and observe the foliage and make sure that it's dry.
Okay, and it looks like we just have one final question that's in the chat. Have you or the ag engineers studied and validated the benefits of towers on a spray rig for citrus?
I don't know about in citrus. I mean, a tower, there's been some work in almonds on using different types of sprayers to target the top of the trees. And there's And there's been some work on different types of sprayers and fan setups. Franz, do you have anything to comment on using? I mean, certainly towers help, you know, if you get those nozzles up in the air, closer to the target, the drops have farther to go. And that can be beneficial, but there needs to be fan air up there too.
I think the data I've seen says that you get more uniform coverage from bottom to top with towers. Peter Larby would know the answer to this question because he was a graduate student at University of Florida. And I know Saliani, Masoud Saliani, the researcher recently retired from Florida, has done a lot of spray coverage work with towers and citrus. And I think he concluded that coverage was better. I don't know if it was necessarily made a difference in crop protection though. The Australians and folks in Florida have done the work. I can look, but I'm not, that's as much as I know, I'm afraid. Coverage is better, pest management, it's hard to say.
Great.
Okay, that looks like that's all of the questions we had. So yeah, we still have about 38 people, I think, who stayed on. So thank you everybody for staying there. And Lynn and Franz, thank you so much for presenting.
And well, thank you everyone. That was really fun. And thanks for sticking with us. Good luck with the rest of your season, everyone.